It is Monday, 7:30 in the morning. This is going to be the second day continuous recording, so we're going to head back out to Greer. And today we have the Orbea Wild M10, I believe. The owner is Brandon from our first episode with the Crestline. Pretty excited to go back to Greer because Greer is one of those places that has everything you need to dial in the bike or to test the bike, to test its features, to test its abilities. I'm actually really excited to see the Orbea Wild from Brandon because he's a really cool guy to ride with, loves customizing his bikes. So he is a perfect fit for this channel. The model is a M10, right?
M20.
Oh, M20.
Started as an M20.
Okay. What was the original?
It's a RockShox 35 silver. I never even rode it. Really took it home and put it on the bike stand, tore it apart.
Yeah.
Never rode it.
The shocks were?
It was a Fox.
Was it a Float? Float-X?
Float.
That's weird. They do like a
opposite.
Fox, yep. And RockShox.
Yeah. The only thing on this bike that's stock is the frame, motor, and battery. It's my M20 Super Custom.
Your own team edition.
Team edition on steroids.
Yeah.
Even the little bolt on the controller is
better bolt. The travel of this bike is 170, 160.
Currently it's 180, 160. And I did that for a reason.
Okay.
This bike is very rigid.
Mm-hmm.
They made the frame more rigid from the previous version. It's got carbon wheels. It's got carbon bars. It's got a Fox 38 on the front. So is what I did to kind of overcome all that is I went 180 more sag.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm running about a 30% sag on the fork, which is quite a bit, and a 30% sag on the shock itself. That gives me a little softer ride to overcome the overall rigidity. The biggest thing with this bike is trying to get it set up to where it feels plush.
Mm-hmm.
This one's been a challenge. I think I'm getting a handle on it.
Okay. I think you just have to ride more.
I got
to
ride it more. I got to ride it more.
Because you're riding your Crestline all the
time.
Yeah, that's the thing. And you said you're on a 400.
I believe I went down to a 400. I started off on a 450 because I wanted to try out 25% sag, which mm-hmm. gave me a perfect 25.
Mm-hmm.
It was too stiff, mm-hmm. way too stiff.
How much do you weigh?
Geared up 225.
225 yeah. And 400.
400. 400 is giving me a 30% sag.
That's very low. With different bikes that have different
leverage ratios. Yeah. Sometimes it's trial and error. Sometimes you hit it right off. You know,
it's
there's
true.
Calculators out there that can get you close, but once you get a spring, you're stuck with it. There's no adjusting air pressures. Or
a lot of people ask the question on the headset, like how do you change the headset because they have the internal routing, right? Do you have to use their stock and what type of modifications did you do to get the headset in? So what did you do to get the Yoshis on there?
Right.
And how did you do it?
Okay, so this is one of the things that I really don't like about this bike.
Okay.
It's probably the main thing. I have to. So when I first got this bike, so it comes stock with a knock block, spin block is what they call it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's basically a piece of metal that's inset into the carbon.
Mm-hmm.
Then they have their proprietary system that kind of locks in on this piece right here. So when you spin, it locks the bars from spinning. You know, when you crash, sometimes your bars will be crooked. That's what it's supposed to do.
Okay.
If you're putting all that pressure on that little block inside the carbon
mm-hmm.
and you make it too rigid, it's gonna bust the carbon.
Yeah.
So there has to be a breaking point, the weakest link in the chain, right?
Yeah.
Which is this collector right here. It's made out of plastic or some form of molded composite. It's very thin right here where the cables come through.
Mm-hmm.
That's your weak link, and that's what's breaking.
Okay.
So if you keep the spin block in and you keep the stock stem, which is locked in, when you crash, it's going to find the weakest link,
mm-hmm.
which is that spin block, and mm-hmm. that's where they're breaking. So is what I did is because when you turn the bars, they clear. I took the spin block out.
Mm-hmm.
I shaved. At the time, this piece wasn't available without this hump.
Okay.
This hump is hollow underneath, so you can only shave down so much
mm-hmm.
before it breaks through. So I shaved 10 mil off of this hump. I put a 10 mil spacer here, clears the Yosh stem right there.
Okay.
So it brings the Yosh stem up. So now I can utilize any stem I want. I'm not stuck with the Arbea stem. I no longer have the spin block in there, which eliminates the weak link. For maintenance purposes and my personal preference, I went wireless, which got rid of two cables that run through, blocked off the extra holes, cleaner cockpit, easier to maintain. Right. If I ever have to re-grease the bearings inside, I can literally do it while everything's still hooked up. I don't have a bunch of cables going through it.
Right.
I'm all about innovation. This one didn't work for me. I don't think it...
Is it worth all that trouble?
No, because realistically, all you're going to get is just another 3 inches of cable showing if you just route it down here. You keep this nice and tight.
The battery on the M20, is it a
750.
750,
yeah.
Right?
The M10, M20, the H versions will all fit a 630 or a 750. The problem is again, the second thing that I hate about this bike is, which it doesn't bother me as much because I don't remove my batteries, but you have to drop the motor.
Okay.
Almost have to drop the battery to route this cable because there's no channeling. There's no internal channeling.
So it's just free.
It runs right down between the frame and the battery. It's kind of squished in there. I think the bike as a whole, it's great.
Mm-hmm.
There are some misses, and what I do like about this bike is the lines.
Yes.
It's a very beautiful, crafted machine. It's almost like a piece of art.
Yeah. Yeah.
The way that the lines are just straight down. I've had 5 Orbea bikes. And you just don't get the creaking in the pivots like you do in a lot of other bikes.
Mm-hmm.
This one is no exception.
They did a really good paint job on this too. I mean, from today's sun, you can kind of see the raw carbon. In my photos or in my video, you're going to feel like, hey, what's going on with the carbon? Because you can see all the...
Almost looks like an imperfection.
Yeah, it looks like an imperfection, but it's not. Like, just seeing the exposed carbon, but there is a finish. There is also like a sparkle finish to this, which is pretty nice.
It's almost like a translucent colored metallic over a raw carbon look. I wasn't a fan of this color at first, but it has grown on me. And
it's very sexy.
Yeah, I think
it's a very sexy bike. How tall are you again?
I'm 5'9".
5'9". So you're a little bit taller than me. And you're 250 something?
No, 225 geared up.
And what size is this bike?
It's a large.
It's a large bike.
I sat on a medium. When I went to the bike store, they actually had, I went there for the medium that they had online. And I sat on it and I was like,
too small?
A little too short for me.
What's the reach on the bike? Can you remember?
That I'd have to look at.
Do you find this reach too much?
Or no, actually, this is, it's, I want to say that the reach I have now is right in the 470 to 480s.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that's where I kind of need to be. 460s, little short. I feel cramped.
And you can do mullet setup on this?
It's not set up for that. It has no...
It wants to be a 29.
It's built to be a 29er. Okay. There's no flip chips. There's no adjustable chain stays, nothing. I did have a mullet set up on it when I first got it just to see what it would do. Night and day difference in rolling. Didn't really feel the benefit in the corners and stuff because it already is a pretty short chain stay for a 29er bike.
Cool.
I want to say it's 440 something maybe.
Okay, we'll have those numbers
again. I don't have those exact numbers, but in doing the research, it is pretty short for a 29 bike. It
pops really good, climbs good.
It climbs really.
I mean, it is like in Lone Wolf. It's like it is an all rounder. Right?
Yeah,
it does everything.
Yeah, it's a great trail to enduro bike.
In your opinion, what does this? What's the one thing that it excels at?
This fast.
Fast, right?
Yeah, it rolls so good. It just, if I had to explain it, it just wants to keep building and building and building. It just goes. You know, I'm not a pro rider. I'm not a beginner. I'm right kind of in the middle. It wants to be ridden fast. It's so rigid, but the suspension just wants to be ridden hard. So the faster you can ride this bike, the better off it's going to give you back. I just wish I was a faster rider. I think I would enjoy it more.
Yeah. That leads to the next question. Would you recommend this bike to a beginner rider?
I don't know. I don't think so just because of what I just said. Mm-hmm. It is a bike in this configuration. It wants to be ridden fast. It wants to be ridden hard. I think the faster you go, the more the suspension's going to work. It could be a beginner bike, but based off of the maintenance, the headset, I don't think I would.
A good bike for anyone that's looking to transition from an analog. If you've been riding analog for like 5-10 years. With that, let's go out. Let's go do some riding. Right, yeah? Let's go do it. The motor is definitely a little bit louder than the Turbo Levo alloy, but it's not too bad. Reluctant to push it real hard. I do feel the steering to be a little bit heavier, but that is likely due to the 38. Very nimble, agile too. Oh. Woo. That punchiness of the Bosch motor gets me over the obstacles pretty good. The bike wants to go fast. It picks up speed really quick out through the berms. Like, it's not stopping. Woo! Ooh, the brakes. Ooh. Definitely getting a little bit used to, but this bike wants to go fast. Woo! Oh shit! Woo! Threw me over the bars a little bit. Really good too for not being in my setting. Woo. This is one serious EMTB. It didn't take much for me to start feeling confident on the Orbea Wild. I immediately felt this bike just wants to keep rolling. It enters the berm fast and it picks up speed extremely fast. However, I did get a feel of the bike's rigidity, but I think with a bit of tweaking, this bike can easily be the best all-rounder, period. Just like how the boys from Lone Wolf reviewed. Brandon has been riding his Crestline all too often and putting this bike on hold. But during our film session, he was getting the feel for the Orbea Wild, and you can see he was feeling way more comfortable with the adjustments he's made. Give Brandon a follow on Instagram and YouTube. The info is in this video's description. I wouldn't recommend this e-bike to a complete beginner. The headset, the non-removable battery, and the fact that the faster you ride, the easier this bike feels can be very, very overwhelming for a new rider. However, if you've been shredding for years, this is the one bike that can do everything. So if you plan on getting this bike, they're still on sale at Jensen USA. Use my affiliate links listed in this video's description along with all the parts discussed in this video. All purchases made through my affiliate links will help this channel directly. Hope you found this video useful. We'll be back with another kick-ass EMTB next week. Hope you all have a great rest of the week. And as always, stay electric. Peace.